Here is baby you. As a baby, you were pretty observant and noticed something pretty early on, the sun. During your first 2 days as a baby, you noticed that this new shiny object, the sun, would rise and subsequently fall. Now, you were pretty smart, which I suppose is fairly obvious given your choice to spend your time on this channel. And so you asked yourself a fairly sophisticated question. What is the chance the sun will rise tomorrow? We are going to answer this question today via Bayesian statistics, and if this is your first time delving into the topic, you may find the final answer to this question quite surprising. If you haven't had a chance yet, I'd encourage you to first watch the first part of our Bayesian series, particularly if Bayes' theorem is new to you. Now, Bayesian statistics is a really fascinating approach to solving problems like this one. High level, it involves us developing statistical models by considering two factors, our judgment and our actual data. And its value is particularly important for problems where we have limited data. For example, suppose that you just designed a traffic intersection so that it should experience only one accident per year. However, a traffic accident occurred in just its first month since opening. Therefore, what is the right estimate around its accident frequency? Unlike classical statistics, the Bayesian approach provides a mathematical framework that allows us to consider both of these factors in revising our initial estimate. So now that we understand the basic premise of Bayesian statistics, let's quickly remind ourselves of Bayes' theorem, and I'll aim to be quick. To explain the behavior of the sun, we are going to rely on a model, and that model is described by some set of parameters. Let's hypothesize that there are two possible parameter values for this model, say E1 and E2, and based on our expert judgment, we have some intuition around the relative probability around which one is the right one. We also know that we've observed the sun 2 days in a row, which I'll refer to as A, and notice that A overlaps with both E1 and E2. This means that there is some probability you would have observed two sunny days in a row with model E1 as well as E2. So, what is the chance then that E1 is the right one given that A has occurred? According to this drawing, it would be the chance of the red hashed area relative to the total area of A. Or in other words, the total probability of observing A and having E1 be the correct model relative to the total chance of observing A. We can now rewrite this equation by knowing that, as was discussed in part one of the series, the probability of two events, say A and E sub I, is equal to the conditional probability of A given E sub I, multiplied by the probability of E sub I. Here, I'm using I to simply index each possible model. And so for any generic model, such as E1, we can rewrite our mathematical relationship as I've done so below. This is Bayes' theorem. Now, I'm going to replace E and A with two different Greek letters. In statistics, it is quite common for us to use theta to refer to a model parameter, and I'll refer to A as epsilon, which are my set of observations. We can then rewrite our equation using this new notation, where the chance of our model parameter theta equaling one possible value, theta sub I, given our data epsilon, is a function of three factors. Our prior, or our initial guess of the probability that theta sub I is the correct parameter value, our likelihood, or the chance we would have observed our available data, given that the model parameter equaled theta sub I, and lastly, our evidence, or the total chance we would have observed our observations for different plausible parameter values. And we combine these three factors to compute our posterior or updated belief that our model parameter theta equals a certain value. With these insights, let's go about actually solving our problem by first defining our prior distribution. We'll model the chance the sun rises tomorrow as following a Bernoulli trial, which is a fairly intuitive idea. There is some probability p that the sun will rise on a given day, and there is a probability of 1 minus p that it will not rise. Here, p is our model parameter. Now, what is the right value of p? We'll assume that you've heard a rumor from other babies in the maternity ward that they have seen the sun before. Therefore, p should definitely not be 0. Now, as you've heard a wide range of opinions, let's assume that we initially believe p is equally likely to be between 0.1 through 1, which we will model in discrete 0.1 increments. We'll do so as I believe the discrete solution to this problem is a bit more intuitive than the continuous one. Now that we've defined our prior, let's compute the likelihood of observing our data for each plausible value for p. We can refer to this as a likelihood function, which refers to the chance of observing some set of data given different parameter values. Before plotting our likelihood function, let's work out one numerical example. What is the probability of two consecutive sunny days given that p equals 0.1? if we assume independence, meaning that the probability of a sunny day does not depend on previous outcomes, then it would be 10% times 10%, or 0.1 squared. We can now generalize this statement for any arbitrary value of p and plot the resulting likelihood function. Unsurprisingly, the value of p that maximizes the chance of observing two consecutive sunny days is p equaling 1. Now let's compute the probability of observing our evidence. We have initially considered 10 possible values of p, each with a 10% chance of occurrence, so let's draw this visually. Now, before we solve for the total chance of our evidence, let's answer the following question. What is the chance of observing our data and having p equal 1? Well, we know initially we believe there is a 10% chance that p equals 1. And if p equals 1, we should have seen the sun the last 2 days with 100% certainty. And therefore, the answer is 10%. An alternative way to view what we just did is that we computed the product of our likelihood with our prior to compute the shaded area. To make sure that makes sense, try to answer a similar question. What is the chance of observing our data and having p equal 0.9? If you take the product of our likelihood and prior values, you should get 0.081. We initially believe that there is a 10% chance that p should equal 0.9, and if it is indeed the right value, the chance we would have observed two sunny days in a row would be 90% times 90%, or 81%. And we can now similarly do the same calculation for our other possible values for p. Now, as there are 10 distinct parameter values that could have led to our evidence, the total probability of our evidence is the summation of the probability we would have observed our evidence for each value for p. This is the total red shaded area, which in this problem is 0.385. So now that we've generated a prior distribution, estimated a likelihood function, and computed the chance of observing our evidence, let's compute our posterior distribution for p. Remember, our posterior is equal to our likelihood times our prior divided by our evidence. So let's remind ourselves of our prior distribution and likelihood functions from earlier, and let's now generate our posterior distribution. Let's work out the calculation for one possible value of p, the situation where it equals 1. Our likelihood value for p equals 1 is 1, our prior is 0.1, and the total chance of observing our evidence is 38.5%. Therefore, our updated belief that p equals 1 is now 26%. We can now do the same calculation for each possible value for p, leading to the following posterior distribution. At the start of our analysis, we thought that all considered values of p were equally likely. However, we realized that higher values of p were more likely to have led us to observing two consecutive sunny days, and so that fact has been reflected in our updated distribution for p. Now, before we solve our original problem, let's understand the effect of both our sample size and prior distribution on our resulting posterior distribution. Remember, our likelihood function and posterior distribution are based on observing two consecutive sunny days. Let's now increase the number of consecutive days, n, that we have observed the sun rise. Unsurprisingly, the more consecutive sunny days we observe, the stronger our belief that the correct value for p is 1. This should make sense, as it is pretty unlikely to observe, say, 50 consecutive sunny days for any value of p that is not 1. Now let's reset n to 2, but now alter our initial prior distribution to understand its effect on our posterior. Rather than a discrete, uniform distribution, suppose that you initially believed in one of the following prior distributions. The middle one suggests that you initially believed that p would be closer to 0, while the bottom one indicates that you initially believed that p would be closer to 1. We can now show our likelihood functions, which are exactly the same as before, as our likelihood functions do not depend on our prior distributions. They simply reflect the chance of observing our data for different parameter values. However, when we combine these two together, we generate the following posterior distributions. And you can note that our posterior distribution for these three situations ends up being quite different. However, just like before, let's suppose that you observe the sunrise for a much larger number of days. If this happened, our three posterior distributions converge to a similar distribution, which should make sense. With more data, we begin to gain a pretty strong sense around which parameter value we should be favoring. So, after all of this, let's see if we can answer two final questions. First, if you had to select just one value of p to model the chance the sun will rise tomorrow, what would you choose? And second, what is the chance the sun will rise tomorrow? At the start of the analysis, we thought that each value of p between 0.1 and 1 was equally likely. However, with this new data, we now have a posterior distribution that reflects our updated belief in terms of which p is the right one. Now, if we want to report a single value for p that we believe is our best estimate of that parameter, which we can call an estimator, a very common one in Bayesian statistics is the parameter's expected value or mean. Now, the mean for anything uncertain is simply a weighted average of each possible outcome that it can take on, weighted by its probability of occurrence. And so, based on our tabulated probabilities, which I've shown you graphically throughout our video, our Bayesian estimator for p would be 0.786. Now, how can we use our distribution to determine the probability that we will see the sun tomorrow? Well, one thing we could do is evaluate the probability that the sun will rise for each possible parameter value, weighted by the chance that the parameter value is the true one. And the probability the sun will rise is simply the summation of each of these probabilities. For this particular problem, given that p is implicitly the probability that the sun will rise, then this equation is simply our Bayesian estimator from earlier, and therefore we arrive at 0.786. And that's it. We believe there is a 78.6% chance the sun will rise tomorrow. If you've made it to the end of this video, really well done. You should now have a strong sense of how to estimate a posterior distribution in Bayesian statistics, you should understand the effects of your sample size on your posterior distribution, and you should now know both how to generate a Bayesian estimator for a parameter and how to use our posterior distribution to answer a probabilistic question. I hope that you found this video helpful. I've included a link in the description to a Python-based solution to this problem. Like, share, and don't hesitate to let me know in the comments if there are other topics that you'd like to learn more about. Thanks as always, and I'll see you soon.